Now, this is a very important slide of how the, maths really works. Okay? Now, if you look at excise duty and customs duty, whatever projections, have been made, a lot of those increases between fiscal 2014 and fiscal 2013 is purely coming because of growth. So if you do a 13.4% number on the previous year's numbers, you will get a similar number for customs duty and excise. So there is no change in excise rates. He's purely assuming that he will collect excise and customs based on the nominal GDP growth rate. Now look what's happened to service tax. If you have to use the same logic for service tax, assume a 13.4% nominal GDP growth rate on the previous year, you will end up with collections of only about 17,000 crores. But he's forecasting another additional 30,000 crores. This 30,000 crores has come because he has now come out with a service tax amnesty scheme. For those who have not been paying service tax for last 5 years from October 2007, he has told them that you can come and pay your service tax with a waiver of penalties. And therefore, there's this big 30,000 number which he's banking on. If this number does not come, then our fiscal deficit targets, would see some slippages. So that's the first point to note. And this number is going to be a kind of a one-off. This number won't be available for next year, that is FY15. So this number is only available for FY14. So that's a one-off. Corporate tax, if you have to use the same logic, you will find that about 13,000 crores is coming because of the surcharge increase. They have increased the surcharge on corporate tax from 5% to 10%. So this seems to be very much in line. As far as income tax is concerned, there also there's a surcharge which has increased, but also there is a tax on the rich for those people earning more than 1 crore. So that's the reason you're seeing this, number of 13,000 crores. This, he mentioned that the additional surcharge is only for a year. And as growth picks up, if he's able to get revenues from growth itself, then these two components, could possibly disappear for the subsequent budget. Remember, this is the last budget of this UPA government. The next budget will not be done by the UPA government. It's a vote of account before the elections. So whatever is being done in this budget, the finance minister has mentioned, it's only for 1 year. We'll have to see what happens in the next, budget once the new government is in power. As far as this is what he's achieving in terms of tax revenues, totally, close to about 58,000 crores is coming from service tax, amnesty, and 1 year surcharge which he has imposed on corporate tax and income tax. The other component which he has basically talked about is increase in dividend receipts. 18,400 crores is additional dividend receipts he's expecting from the public sector companies. So that's a big number. A lot of public sector companies are sitting on cash, so he's asking for this cash back in the form of dividends. So that's how he's meeting the number. And divestments. There are two components. Last year, he had forecast about 30,000 crores as the divestment number. He achieved 24,000 crores. This year, he's forecasting that this 24,000 crores will go to 40,000 crores. So 16,000 crores additional proceeds coming from divestment. But he's also included another 14,000 crores coming from divestment in companies which are non-government entities, which includes, the Sooty stake. It includes the, Balco stake. I don't think the Hindustan Zinc stake is included in these numbers, because if they were to do Hindustan Zinc, the numbers would be much more than 14,000 crores. So I think Balco and Sooty are included in this. And in case of telecom, an additional 22,000 crores has been projected. This will be coming from your one-off spectrum charges on excess spectrum, which is about 16,000 crores. And you also have, another 5,000 crores of flex spectrum charges, which are being also imposed, so totally coming out to about 22,000 crores. There's a small amount for also the auctioning of 800 megahertz of spectrum. So 22,000 crores coming from the spectrum. So if you look at all these components, the more recurring component is he's making a very ambitious target on divestment for next year. And this number, like I said, is a one-off, and we do not know whether he'll actually collect this 30,000 number. So any kind of slippages on this will have a problem in him funding the fiscal deficit. If you look at the total expenditure, and this is something we need to know, a lot of our expenditure in the budget is revenue expenditure. Revenue expenditure is like your consumption expenditure. Whatever you earn, you consume, and it's over. Capital expenditure, you normally invest for the future. Like, for example, you buy a refrigerator. The refrigerator lasts for 4 or 5 years, and it gives you the benefit over the years. So you can see our capital expenditure from the government has been very small compared to the revenue expenditure, which means that the whole onus of capital expenditure or infrastructure creation is now moving to the private sector. If you look at the planned expenditure, this is in percentage terms. So planned expenditure is still a big, small component compared to the non-planned expenditure. Non-planned expenditure, I mentioned to you, includes interest subsidies, which are relatively sticky. Planned expenditure is where he's been able to, you know, play around with. Like I said, suddenly when he has projected almost 26% of the planned expenditure growth in FY13, he grew only by 0.6%. So it looks to be something which is very discretionary. He can pull the plug any time if the fiscal deficit numbers are not in line. But that has an impact on growth. Now, one of the biggest issues that we have had is subsidy, and there are various components of subsidy. If you look at 2013 revised estimates, subsidy as a percentage of GDP was 2.6% of GDP. He had forecast that he'll keep this, you know, in the region of around 2%. If you look at the numbers for the next year, he's once again saying that I will try and achieve a subsidy to GDP ratio of 2%. There are food subsidy, fertilizer subsidy, petroleum subsidy, interest rate subsidy. In food subsidy, main component of this is the minimum support prices that you give for, you know, the farmers for their various produce. He's also included now the food security bill. The food security is basically food for all, is the ambition of this UPI government. The bill is not yet passed by parliament. So a 10,000 crore number is a number, assuming that the bill is not immediately passed. Even if it is passed, it won't be a nationwide rollout. Even if it's a nationwide rollout, it's going to be only for part of the year. So 10,000 crores is a small number, but if you were to look at the annualized impact of the food security bill, if it was done on a nationwide basis and on an annualized basis, will be out of order of around 60,000 crores plus. So it's a big number which will actually hit the fiscal deficit once it's in full, it's fully implemented. So as of now, it's a very small number because it's partial implementation and only for a small period of time. So this number actually includes both the impact of the minimum support prices and the food security bill. My view is that there has been some under-provisioning on this number. You could see some increases, but not really alarming in nature. Petroleum subsidy, he has projected last year a petroleum subsidy of around 43,580 crores, and I mentioned in my last meeting that he has under-provided for. He's finally ended up with a number of close to 97,000 crores. Next year, he's projecting 65,000 crores. So why is the next year number so significantly lower than this number? Out of the 65,000 crores, 40,000 crores pertains to this year. So it's a spillover from this year into next year. 25,000 crores is a number which he has projected for next year. Now, one of the reasons for this drop is because of the fact that he's implementing an increase of diesel prices on a monthly basis. So that will take the overall subsidy number down. Second is he has capped the number of LPG cylinders to 9. So that will bring down the overall subsidy number. And my sense is that next year, the upstream oil companies will share 50% of the subsidy burden and not 40%. And that's the reason he's bringing down this number further. If you look at oil at about $105 for the barrel average, there would be a shortfall of around close to 20,000 crores in this number. If it's $110 per barrel, it will be about 26,000 crores of the shortfall. So this is the extent of slippage that we'll finally see. So this number itself will move closer to this number next year. And it's a function of oil prices. So if oil prices go up, the subsidy number goes up. But the important point to note is that the sharing from the on the upstream companies will move up, because they'll try to maintain the absolute number of subsidy for the upstream companies to be similar. So if the subsidy, overall subsidy is coming down, to keep it at the same absolute level, they will increase the sharing from the upstream oil companies. So that's our view. Just to give you a sense, on the retail prices of LPG cylinder, I gave you this slide last year also. The current retail price is $435. If oil is at $110 to the barrel, then the actual price, the market price, should be $805. So the difference between these two is a subsidy that has been given to the consumer. So now he's capping this only to 9 cylinders per year. So that is one benefit that you'll get. So you're actually paying the market prices for the cylinders more than 9. If you look at kerosene, Current retail price is 14.4. If you were to put the $110 per barrel and price it at market prices, it's 46. The difference between this is a subsidy on kerosene. Based on what I've heard in terms of post-budget interviews with the finance minister, he's looking at no measure to sort of increase the price of kerosene or cooking oil. Diesel prices, like I mentioned, they are looking at progressively increasing diesel prices by about 1% every month to reduce the kind of under-recovery that you're seeing in diesel. But the difference in diesel is relatively small, so that can very easily be bridged by this progressive increase in diesel prices every month. I was mentioning to you that there is this gross under-recovery. That means what is the overall subsidy burden based on various oil prices? And you can see that, you know, if the oil price is $105 for the barrel, the overall shortfall in provisioning in the budget is 20,000 crores. If it goes to $110 for the barrel, the overall shortfall will be almost 29,000 crores. So if the oil price goes to 120, then it's actually underprovided to the extent of 47,000 crores. So this is a very good sensitivity chart to use to just figure out as to where the subsidy, you know, burden is going to be and how it's going to impact the overall fiscal deficit. Coming to infrastructure, like I said, it's an ongoing, you know, program. Infrastructure, the issue is not so much of budget policy. There are significant structural issues in execution, be it land, be it availability of fuel. In fact, we did an analysis which states that if you were to look at all the power generation capacity which has been set up, and only if you have coal to fuel all this capacity, we do not need to set up a single megawatt of fresh generation capacity. So the entire issue is availability of fuel and not creating new capacity as far as power generation is concerned. Having said that, they have come up with a new proposal for investment allowance once again. There was a proposal like this earlier. What they're trying to do is kickstart the investment cycle. At the moment, if you go and talk to any private sector company, they are not really investing in CapEx. So the whole onus of CapEx will have to be on public sector companies for this next 12 months. So how do we incentivize public sector, private sector companies to come in? They're given this investment allowance of around 15% given to manufacturing companies that invest more than 100 crores in plant and machinery during this period of fiscal 2014 and fiscal 2015. So for 2 years, you will basically have this benefit of investment allowance, and they're hoping that this will enable people to prepone their CapEx plans and go ahead with them. Remember, this is only for manufacturing companies. There was this question asked whether this was applicable to, you know, companies which were in the hotel industry, but it's not applicable to them because they're not manufacturing companies. He's talking about 3,000 kilometers of road projects to be awarded in the next 6 months. Now, this is wishful thinking in my view. They have been trying to, you know, award these projects. The problem is getting land. If land is not available, there'll be no bidders. So this is the issue. So this is, in my opinion, an ambitious target. He's talking about new industrial corridors, which is Mumbai, Bangalore, and Bangalore, Chennai. For those who are following the industrial corridor story, it's a very interesting project. It results in the creation of number of new cities, and they're called smart cities. I'm bullish on this project, but it's going to be not like going to happen next year. These projects are going to take at least 5-6 years to, you know, get implemented, but it's a good start to build these industrial corridors. And as far as the estimates are concerned, you can see that in terms of FY12, they projected that this number would go from 1,28,000 crores to 1,63,000 crores. But what they ended up was 1,38,000 crores. So they're falling short in terms of infrastructure investments. Once again, they're hoping that this number will go up to 1,74,000 crores. This number is meaningless because at the end of the day, it's all a function of correcting some of the infrastructure bottlenecks, like I said, land, availability of fuel, etc. If that is corrected, then these numbers are achievable. But putting these numbers, in fact, I was talking to the Planning Commission some time back, and I told them that, you know, you have been making very optimistic projections. They are not being achieved. And he says, we don't make projections. What we do is we tell you that if the economy is growing at 8%, then this is the investment you need to make. So it's not a projection. We are telling you for this 8%, this is the projection. For 5%, this is the projection. So it's basically what they do is targeting a particular investment based on the growth rate that you're assuming. So for that, if you're saying the economy is going to grow at between 5.5% to 6%, then obviously the Planning Commission estimates are going to be extremely high, because then the entire numbers have to be reset.